Balitang Amerika's 2015 year-end report is presented by Western Union, moving money for better.
Welcome to Balitang Amerika's Year-End Report and thank you for joining us, Kapamilya. Ako po si Jel Santos Relos.
And I'm Ramel Kinclara. Tonight we look back at some of the stories that shaped our world in 2015.
That's right, Ramel. And we begin with a world figure who left a big impression on Filipinos here in the United States. Our North America Bureau Chief Paul Hanson tells us about Pope Francis' historic American visit. Paul?
Thanks, Jel. 2015 will be remembered for one historic visit. The highest leader of the Catholic Church visits the most powerful nation in the world. The contrast between the two cannot be more stark. Pope Francis, known for his simplicity, love for the poor, and disgust over the abuses of this world. The United States, a bastion of power and capitalism, home to the wealthiest, most forceful institutions in the world. It was a visit that was no less than stunning.
On a clear September afternoon, Pope Francis arrived at the Joint Base Andrews just outside Washington, D.C., and U.S. President Barack Obama rolled out the red carpet. It was a visit of historic proportions. It was the very first time that the Holy Father stepped on U.S. soil. From his very first official function, Pope Francis put a spotlight on the world's most pressing concerns before the nation's most powerful leaders. Francis became the first pope to deliver remarks before the joint session of Congress. He lamented the violent conflicts in the name of religion. He spoke against death penalty. He asked for more compassion for refugees. And at the United Nations, the Holy Father spoke against selfishness and lust for power in the world, the root, he says, of abuse of the environment and the poor. In Philadelphia, the Holy Father stunned a large gathering of bishops and seminarians. He said, God weeps over the sex abuse of children. He warned that all those responsible will be held accountable. Pope Francis met with big leaders in hallowed halls, but his encounters with the poor were the most touching. He shared lunch with the homeless in Washington, D.C., laughed and joked with students of immigrant families in East Harlem, and touched the sick at Madison Square Garden in New York City. Everywhere he went, he was adored. In every gathering, there were Filipino-American families living their faith. The Pope summed it all up by bringing back the glory to God, built on the foundation of every strong family.
On his departure, Pope Francis said he was leaving the U.S. with a heart full of gratitude, a sentiment shared by all that he touched.
Maraming salamat sa iyo, North America Bureau Chief Paul Hanson.
Some of the darkest moments of the year involved unimaginable acts of terror around the world. Right here in America, Kababayans faced justice for their connections to terror groups. In February, Filipino Ralph De Leon was sentenced to 25 years in prison after being convicted of 3 counts of terrorism. And in December, Filipino residents in San Bernardino County were in shock following a mass shooting at a community center for the disabled that left 14 dead. The two shooters, husband and wife Saeed Farouk and Tashfeen Malik, who had links to ISIS, were killed by police in a bloody standoff following the shooting. Investigators later revealed that Farouk ran in the same social circle as Sohail Omar Kabir, the same man convicted of recruiting Ralph De Leon.
But in 2015, crimes involving Filipinos were not limited to acts of terrorism. In Santa Cruz, California, PhilAm teen Adrian Jerry Gonzalez made headlines as a prime suspect in the murder of 8-year-old Maddie Middleton. And PhilAm Jonathan Vian of Alaska was wanted as a prime suspect in the killing of 23-year-old Aika Mojica in Zambales, Philippines. Vian fled to the United States a day after the killing and was arrested in Iowa, where he awaited extradition back to the Philippines to face murder charges. It was supposed to be the fight of the century between the people's champ of the Philippines, Manny Pacquiao, and undefeated American boxer Floyd Mayweather Jr. Bev Barrente looks back at how it all went down. Bev?
Jel, there is no doubt that the showdown between Manny Pacquiao and Floyd Mayweather Jr. in 2015 was the highest grossing event in the history of boxing. From pay-per-view buys to ticket sales, revenues from the Maypac fight totaled more than $500 million.
After years of negotiations, fierce rivalry, and constant bickering between the Pacquiao camp and the Mayweather camp, who would have thought that the Maypac fight would come to fruition?
The point is, you had to deal with ego situation. That made it a lot tougher to get this fight done. There were egos involved, big egos involved.
While both fighters trained hard for the most eagerly awaited showdown, what they each had a different take on what was at stake.
Do you consider this fight as your legacy fight, and how much does zero mean to a legacy?
No, I don't consider this my legacy fight. I feel that every fight played a major key, you know, for my career.
Kung 5 years ago nangyari itong laban o 6 years ago nangyari itong laban, hindi pa ako talaga fully serving the Lord. Ang glory nito is para sa Panginoon.
In review, the welterweight unification showdown between Mayweather and Pacquiao lasted 12 rounds. Mayweather admits that Pacquiao's left hand was fast.
His left hand was fast, his right hand was fast, and he was throwing them both fast and strong.
But the controversy emerged during a post-fight press conference as Pacquiao divulged that he fought Mayweather with an injury in his right shoulder. But the Mayweather camp slammed Pacquiao, accusing the Pinoy fighter of using his injury as an excuse for losing the biggest fight in his boxing career.
I thought he was in the best shape of his life, according to what everybody was saying. And all of a sudden, now it's the leg. He had a leg problem, he had a hand problem, he had a shoulder problem.
And now, months after the big fight, fans who are calling for a rematch are only being answered with uncertainty, wondering if the two champions will ever agree to step into the ring with one another again.
While Floyd Mayweather Jr. announced his retirement last September, Pacquiao is busy campaigning for a senatorial bid in the Philippines in an upcoming fight in 2016 that will once again take place here in Las Vegas, the fighting capital of the world. Back to you, Jel and Romel.
Maraming salamat sa iyo, Bev Lorente. Romel, I think there is going to be a rematch, but they have to make sure that they keep on making the people feel excited, interested about what's going on, because otherwise, wala nang manonood. At pag walang manood, wala nang champing laban, because they want to make money here.
Of course. And Jel, I totally agree with you that there's going to be a rematch. And when that happens, the entire internet will go crazy. And speaking of which, we now break down 2015's most viewed stories on our YouTube channel, TSC Balitang America. At number 3, UFC's former women's champion and avid Manny Pacquiao fan Ronda Rousey threw her one punch for Pac-Man during the mega bout with Floyd Mayweather Jr. This story was viewed over 200,000 times. At number 2 was the story of the Philippines vet for 2014's Miss Universe, MJ Lastimosa, showing off her swimsuit during a poolside runway show. And I'm not at all surprised, it received more than 400,000 views. And the sentencing of two San Diego Pinoy nurses caught in sex acts right in front of their patient was our number one story viewed on YouTube in 2015 with 440,000 views. And those were the most viewed stories on our YouTube channel, TSC Balitang America. Jel?
Thank you, Romel. The race for the presidency in the United States and the Philippines takes off, and our kababayas in Canada get a new prime minister. That's up next when Balitang America's 2015 year-end report returns. Welcome back, Kapamilya. The race for the U.S. presidency kicked off in 2015 with candidates from either side of the aisle fighting tooth and nail for the coveted nominations. Don Tagala tells us more.
The race to the 2016 U.S. presidential elections is in full swing. In the beginning, there were 22 candidates from both Democrats and Republicans combined. While 16 remain today, only 2 from Democrats and 3 from the GOP are leading the polls.
The amazing race to the White House is now in full throttle. The green flag went up in early 2015 with 5 Democratic and 17 Republican hopefuls, each vying for their party's 2016 presidential nomination. Jeb Bush's last name alone gave him an early boost on the road to the Republican National Convention, but not for long. After 3 Republican national debates, billionaire real estate mogul Donald Trump's extreme-style campaign kicked into high gear.
When Mexico sends its people, they're not sending their best. They're not sending you. They're not sending you. They're sending people that have lots of problems.
Dominating the headlines, whether it's about immigration, foreign relations, or national security. Despite his opponents saying over and over that he has no chance to win, Trump continues to lead the polls, taking in 35% to 40% of Republican primary voter support. In national polls, however, Trump's rival Ted Cruz is closing the gap at 18%, and Senator Marco Rubio is now at 11% to 13%. The rest, including Bush, Ben Carson, Carly Fiorina, Rand Paul, Chris Christie, and Mike Huckabee, have single-digit points in the polls.
I certainly am not campaigning to become president because my last name is Clinton.
Meanwhile, just when opponents were praying hard, Hillary Clinton's Benghazi and email scandals will sideswipe her off the racetrack to the White House, a little push from Democratic runner-up Bernie Sanders, and a failed witch hunt on Benghazi propelled Clinton even further into the front-runner status. Today, the former Secretary of State keeps a commanding lead of 55% to 56% among Democratic primary voters, while Senator Bernie Sanders keeps a close second at 34%+, while Governor O'Malley trails behind at 2% to 3%. The other two, Lincoln Chafee and Jim Webb, dropped off the race.
While the road to the White House is becoming narrower each month, it's still early to tell whether it's going to be a Clinton-Trump face-off at the second stage of the presidential campaigns after the National Party conventions in 2016. Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, New York.
In the Philippines, 5 presidential hopefuls emerged in 2015. Here's Henny Espinosa to tell us about some of the big moments of Halalan 2016 so far.
Thanks, Ramel. The Philippine presidential campaign is shaping up to be an exciting time, not just for the candidates, but for the potential voters who are having a field day with the interesting set of characters that makes the presidential list. But will the interest lead to actual votes? Well, that remains to be seen.
Kanya-kanyang sakripisyo, kanya-kanyang tulong, kanya-kanyang ambag para nga may taguyod natin yung daang matuwid.
Mar Rojas, the administration vet, a former cabinet secretary and senator. But is he too out of touch with the problems of the common man?
Patitingkarin natin ang tatlong sangay ng pamalaan na pinahina ng panunuhol at pananakot.
Jejomar Binay, UNA standard bearer, the current vice president, longtime Makati mayor. But are allegations of corruption against him true?
Inaalay ko ang aking sarili sa mas mataas na paninilbihan bilang inyong pangulo.
Nationalista Party's Grace Poe, a neophyte senator and daughter of legendary actor and former presidential candidate Fernando Poe Jr. But will she survive the disqualification cases against her, questioning her Filipino citizenship?
If I become president sometime in the very near future, this country will be much better.
People Reform Party's Miriam Defensor Santiago, a seasoned politician who had run for president twice. But are voters going to take a risk and choose her, knowing that she has not fully beaten lung cancer?
Nasabi ko sa inyo, hindi ako mamamatay pag hindi ako presidente.
If you would notice, I have a nonchalant attitude about the presidency.
Rodrigo Duterte of the PDP Laban is Davao City's sharp-talking, straight-shooting mayor. But are Filipino voters really going to vote for someone who proudly admitted to killing hundreds of criminals? How do they plan to bring progress to the Philippines? Rojas, who is running with Congresswoman Leni Robredo as vice president, vows to relentlessly continue Aquino's Daang Matuwid, promising to fight corruption and address poverty. Binay, whose running mate is Senator Gringo Hunasan, promises to deliver more by creating an open government for the public that's open to foreign investors. Po, who is running with Senator Chis Escudero, wants to focus on family and family-oriented programs. She wants confidence in the justice system to be restored and for the government to execute laws effectively in order to deter crimes. Santiago, whose running mate is Senator Bongbong Marcos, wants to improve health and education services. Duterte, who is running with Alan Peter Cayetano, wants to prioritize federalism and law and order.
In 5 months, Filipinos in the homeland and in other parts of the world will determine who will be the 16th president of the Philippines. But beyond the question which candidate is the most interesting, voters may instead focus on which one will make the best leader, someone who can actually turn things around in a country that's hungry for change. Maraming salamat sa iyo, Henry Espinosa. The headlines that affected our kababayans in Canada this year: a visit from President Noynoy Aquino, immigration policy changes for temporary workers, and a literally trashy scandal that's Canada's newly elected Prime Minister promises to clean up. Mariton Pacheco has this report.
Jel, Canadians, including Kababayans, voted for change in government this 2015. But while we have a new prime minister, the issues for many Filipinos here, including temporary workers, remain the same. 2015 marked a grim deadline for many temporary foreign workers in Canada after the 4-and-4 rule was implemented in April. This limits temporary workers' stay in Canada for a maximum of 4 years. They can only re-enter to work after another 4. The rule forced many Pinoy workers, not yet qualified for permanent residency, to leave the country. Live-in caregivers also saw longer wait times on the processing of their permanent residency applications. Employers found it harder and more costly to get the required permits ever since changes to the LCP in 2014.
How do I move? How do I go about? Paano ako mabubuhay? Kasi hindi naman ako pwedeng magtrabaho ng basta-bastang walang papel. Otherwise, madedeport ako.
Many Kababayans hope Philippine President Noynoy Aquino's state visit to Canada last May would help the status of temporary workers in the country. Aquino's visit highlighted the growing contributions of the Filipino community in Canada, with numbers estimated at 800,000 already.
Nakakatuwa naman para sa mga kamag-anak namin na nandoon pa. At kung babalik kami sa Pilipinas para bumisita at daladala namin ang mga anak at asawa namin, hindi na masyadong mahirap sa katawan ang biyahe, di ba? So, napakagandang balita kung ganun talaga.
But nothing was done on the problems of temporary Pinoy workers in Canada. In October, Liberal Party leader Justin Trudeau became the country's new prime minister. Trudeau's campaign promises focused on lowering taxes for the middle class, allowing more refugees in Canada, and family reunification. The new prime minister, meantime, had other issues to tackle, like 2 Canadians kidnapped in Mindanao and the controversy over Canada's trash sent to Philippine soil. At the APEC summit in Manila, Trudeau said they will work on legislation to make Canadian companies more responsible so that this doesn't happen again. Mariton Pacheco, ABS-CBN News, Vancouver.
Maraming salamat sa iyo, Mariton Pacheco. APEC hotties, sino nga kaya talagang nanalo? Team Trudeau o Team Nieto?
You know what, to tell you the truth, Jel, I think it's a really close tie because everyone on social media was talking about that. And speaking of social media, we now look back to our social media platforms to find 2015's most retweeted, most liked, and most commented on stories. On Twitter, 2015's most retweeted story was Hollywood correspondent Yong Chavez's exclusive interview with Philippine teen star Liza Soberano. This story had 84 retweets and was liked 107 times. The year's biggest story on Facebook about the Golden State Warriors being the first team in the NBA to show Pinoy pride by wearing the special Filipino Heritage Night shooting shirts, according to Facebook Analytics, this story received 7,381 reactions, comments, and shares. And the story that received the most comments on our website was filmmaker and journalist Jose Antonio Vargas's race-based documentary on MTV called White People. The story received 43 comments on our website and 9 comments on the YouTube link. Again, be sure to keep the conversation going on Twitter, Facebook, and on BelievingAmerica.tv. Jel?
Thank you, Romel Conclara. A Filipino church in crisis and triumphs for Pinoys in the sports arena. We'll tell you all about it when Balitang America's 2015 year-end report returns.
Mga kapamilya, ako po'y taus-puso nagpapasalamat sa walang sawang pagtangkilik at pagtitiwala ninyo sa amin. Asahan ninyo na lalo pa naming pagbubutihin ang aming serbisyo at paghuhusayin ang aming mga programa upang mas matulungan namin kayong malutas ang inyong mga problemang pinansyal. 7 years na po ang financial rescue at hindi po kami tatagal ng ganito kung hindi dahil sa inyo. In fact, karamihan sa aming mga kliyente ay naging malapit na mga kaibigan at naging parte na rin ng lumalaking komunidad ng mga debt-free individuals. At ito ay nagsisilbing inspirasyon sa amin. Ang aming mga debt settlement programs ay mga konkretong solusyon upang mapalaya sila sa kanilang malaking pagkakautang. Ang turuan at bigyang ng sapat na kaalaman sa usaping pinansyal ang ating mga kababayan ay naging advocacy ko na rin sa nakalipas na 7 taon. Sa papalapit na taong 2016, mas marami pa kami mga idadagdag na serbisyo para sa inyo. Sa katunayan, maaari na rin namin kayo matulungan sa inyong mga problema sa IRS. Asahan ninyo na mas improved na legal support sa aming mga debt settlement programs. Abangan ang lahat ng yan sa 2016. Muli po, nagpapasalamat ako sa inyo at sana'y magsama-sama pa rin tayo sa mga susunod na taon. We wish you a prosperous and a happy debt-free new year. Let's welcome the new year with hope and of course, with determination na kayang-kaya nating solusyonan ang ating mga problemang pinansyal. Hanggang sa muli po, ako po si Rod Mercado. To the rescue!
We are back with Balitang America's 2015 year-end report. This year, corruption allegations erupted from members of the Iglesia ni Cristo, with members demanding answers from their leaders. Here's Romel Conclara to tell us more.
Jel, the Brethren of the Iglesia ni Cristo just came from celebrating their centennial anniversary in 2014. However, only a year later, the celebration quickly turned into scandal after calls of criminality and abduction claims began to make headlines in the Philippines and in the U.S.
Nananawagan po kami sa inyo dahil nangangani po ang aming buhay.
This video of Iglesia ni Cristo minister Felix Nathaniel Angel Manalo and his mother Christina Tenny Manalo pleading for public help surfaced just one day prior to their expulsion from the church by Executive Minister Eduardo Manalo. Eduardo claims that the expulsion of his brother, mother, other family members, and church ministers was the price they paid for allegedly causing divisions in the church and plotting to seize power. Former INC officers and ministers in the U.S. reached out to Balitang America to publicly air their grievances, all related to claims that corruption, greed, and intimidation had infected the church they once cherished. Their demands? Accountability. Answers for those who called themselves leaders.
What we want is for the members, who there are a lot more of us who feel the same way, to not be threatened to be expelled.
Some called themselves defenders, seeking to protect the purity of the church. They held numerous protests outside of the U.S. main office in the San Francisco Bay Area and in front of chapels across California.
They stopped persecuting the members who have shown light to other members by speaking the truth, speaking of the corruption.
Church officials responded by saying, protesters are only interfering with members' right to worship in peace and threaten legal action against them.
What they're doing there is they're libeling the Church of Christ. They're making defamatory statements that have no basis in fact.
In late November, one former INC minister, Vincent Florida, went to the IRS, asking the agency to investigate how the church handles its finances and taxes in the United States, claiming the officials were involved in tax fraud and diversion of funds.
And while people on each side continue to remain as unrelenting opponents, they both agree that God will provide them with the truth. Jill?
Thank you, Romel. A scandal out of the Ninoy Aquino International Airport in Manila, the Tanim Bala or bullet planting scam, nabbed international attention this year. Travelers from all over the world passing through Naia started wrapping their luggage in plastic after reports emerged that airport security employees were allegedly planting bullets in their bags in an effort to extort money from them. An outrage from Filipinos in the United States over fears that balikbayan boxes they send back home would be tampered with in new random inspections by the Philippine Bureau of Customs.
It was another banner year for the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender community, with a high-profile coming-out story and a historic legal victory. Olympic icon and reality TV star Caitlyn Jenner stepped up as a new voice for trans people all over the world. In late June, this U.S. Supreme Court granted same-sex couples the right to marry nationwide. Meanwhile, in the Philippines, U.S. Marine Joseph Scott Pemberton was found guilty of homicide of transgender Filipina Jennifer Lade and was sentenced to 6 to 12 years in prison.
I have to apologize.
And it was an awkward moment when host Steve Harvey admitted that he mistakenly announced Miss Colombia as a winner, but a win nonetheless when Miss Philippines Pia Wurtzbach was officially crowned Miss Universe. This was the first time in more than 40 years that the Philippines captured the title.
From the basketball court to the putting green and, of course, the boxing ring, athletes with Pinoy roots made 2015 a year to remember in the sports arena. Here's Steve Angeles with a story.
Manny Pacquiao may have suffered an injury and lost in the fight of the century, but other Filipino athletes gave Pinoy something to be proud of in 2015. 2015 may have been the most successful year for Filipinos on basketball courts. The Los Angeles Lakers found a star in the making in Phil-Am Jordan Clarkson. The Texas Braves point guard with Angeles City roots put on a spectacular rookie year, earning all rookie team honors.
I just work hard, man, trying to get the best results and trying to be great. So, I'm continuing to learn every day.
After a series of tryouts and a stint in the NBA Summer League, two-time UAAP MVP Bobby Ray Parks has found his way to the NBA D-League with the Texas Legends, part of the Dallas Mavericks system. A prodigy with a PBA pedigree lived up to the hype in his first year as an American high school student. UCLA-bound Toby Faras wowed audience with his all-around skill, winning the FIBA Under-18 Slam Dunk Contest in Hungary.
It's a great experience. Given a chance for me to play here, only pure Filipino from the Philippines who just came here.
In a partnership with TFC, four ALA boxing fighters made their U.S. debuts in Carson, California with Pinoy Pride 33. Albert Pagada, Mark Magsayo, and Jason Pagada all scored big early knockout wins, while history-making champion Donnie Nietes put on a brilliant performance, which launched him into WBO super champion status.
Juarez snuck a body shot in, and there's a
the Filipino flash known Nito Donaire ended 2015 by capturing the Super Bantamweight title in a Fight of the Year nominated slugfest against Mexican Cesar Juarez.
The spectacular fight!
In golf, Filipino-Australian Jason Day capped off 2015 with one of golf's top honors as the U.S. PGA champion. Winter Olympian Michael Martinez fought off injuries to bag gold at the Asia Open in Thailand and the Triglav Trophy in Slovenia. 2015 proved that Filipinos of all ages and all sports are indeed world-class and champions. And with many of these Filipinos still young and hungry, the future looks bright on the playing field.
And with that, we conclude tonight's 2015 year-end report. Kapamilya, maraming salamat po sa inyong patuloy na pagtitiwala sa Balitang Amerika. Ako po si Jel Santos Relos.
And I'm Ramel Quintero. On behalf of everyone on the Balitang Amerika News Team, we wish you all a Happy New Year.
Balitang
Balitang Amerika's 2015 year-end report was presented by Western Union, moving money for better.